Our first speaker this morning is Dr. Kara Pratt, who is a neuroscientist who has been pushing back the boundaries of knowledge about how the brain develops from its earliest unformed stages to a mature, fully functioning organ. Given this expertise, it's not surprising that most of her more than 24 published articles appear in journals with names like Neuron, Journal of Neuroscience, Developmental Neurobiology, and so on. But just a year after earning her bachelor degree many years ago and going to work for a lab run by Pfizer Pharmaceuticals, Kara began her publishing career as a co-author of an article in the prestigious journal Science. In the two decades since then, Kara has been working at the cutting edge of brain research and earned her PhD along the way. In 2011, she was hired at the University of Wyoming as part of its expanding graduate neuroscience program and its neuroscience center. Here, she helps train students from Wyoming, nation, and from around the world to expand our understanding of the brain and how it works and how it thinks. Professor Pratt's arrival at UW enabled her to focus on a growing interest, that of the way the developing brains learn how to see. That is, how they take signals transmitted from the eyes and transform them into the visual image we know as sight. Of course, what she really wants to understand is humans and how humans see, but you know, it's sort of hard to do the kind of research on the human brain. You know, we have this hard piece of bone around it that makes it tough to get at. So she works with tadpoles that she will tell you about. And the key here is that the skin is transparent so that as the brain develops, she can actually watch it through the skin. And since the processes of tadpole brains and human brains are surprisingly comparable, by understanding the sight development of tadpoles, she can understand at least to a certain extent, how human visions work. So today, join me in welcoming Professor Kara Pratt, who will speak to us about how the brain learns to see, studying tadpoles to understand people. Kara.
Thank you, Paul. Well, Paul just gave my entire talk. So my talk, I'm going to talk today about what we know about how the brain learns to see. So this is a visual illusion, an optical illusion. So probably some of you are seeing this dancer turn clockwise. And some of you, though, might be seeing her turn counterclockwise. Some of you may actually see her switch directions. For myself, I can only see her switch directions if I look at her out of the corner of my eye and imagine she's turning the opposite way. Why do some of us see her turning clockwise? And why do some of us others see her turning counterclockwise? The answer to that is it all comes down to the way your visual system is built. So there's slight differences in the way our individual visual systems are built, and this is going to determine exactly what we see here. Okay? And I think this is an excellent example of how our visual system completely determines our visual experience. Okay? So, my lab and many labs are interested in learning about how the visual system, how neural circuits in general wire themselves up. And for today, I'm going to be covering, and they said this should be like a lecture that I would present for one of my classes. So here we will cover these topics. neural circuits, so I'll first define exactly what we mean by neural circuit, what it's comprised of, and why they are important, and why are they interesting. I'll tell you about our model circuit a lot. It's that we use the Xenopus lavis tadpole. How neural circuits develop and especially activity-dependent mechanisms involved. And that won't mean anything to you now, but it will mean a lot more to you by the end of this talk. And then that leads to how activity-dependent mechanisms lead to circuit refinement, right? So first, let's start by defining what we mean exactly by neural circuits. So neural circuits are comprised of neurons, also known as brain cells. And this is a little schematic showing three brain cells, brain cell 1, 2, and 3. And you can see here that brain cell 1 is projecting its axon over to the cell 2, brain cell 2. And when it does this, when it's activated, it will send a signal, an action potential will travel down this axon, contact cell 2, and activate the dendrites of cell 2. So the dendrites are considered the input region of a cell. It's where the input from cell 1 comes in, all right? And if, and only if, that input from cell 1 is strong enough to activate this dendrite region here, it will cause this cell to fire an action potential, and that will travel down and contact cell 3, and so forth. So our brains are really made up of levels of cells, and they form connections between them. And this is how information is conveyed. So for instance, your eye, when the retinal ganglion cells in your eye get activated, they're going to form synaptic connections onto a very certain set of neurons in your brain.
Can I ask a question?
Sure, I welcome them.
Are those electrical?
These are chemical. So we have neurotransmitter released from the presynaptic terminal of this axon onto, this transmitter crosses the very, very small space in between these two cells, and it will, if there are the receptors on this dendrite, activate those receptors. And like I said, if that input is strong enough, it's going to activate an action potential in this cell. Okay? That is how information is conveyed. And I do welcome questions, because I'd rather you ask and stay with the talk than spend the whole time wondering what she meant on slide 2. All right, so now that's fine. So neurons make connections. Neurons have the amazing ability to self-assemble into circuits. So they know they will default, actually, to wiring themselves up. And I know this I got extremely interested in this concept. When I was a grad student at Brandeis, I was culturing, growing, harvesting cortical neurons from a rat pup, plating them onto a dish. Not only do those neurons live, they settle down onto the floor and send out dendrites and axons, and they default to making circuits. So they have an innate ability. This is what they're made to do. And so they have this amazing ability. Their default state is to forming circuits. Not just any random ones, they form functional ones. That's why when we see visual stimuli, we can perceive. So even more impressive than this ability to self-assemble is this idea that the human brain, the average human brain, contains approximately 100 billion neurons, which is a lot, compressed into the space of the skull, just like Paul said. So very, very compressed, 100 billion neurons with 10 times more connections made. So how does it get it right?
Yes. You say innate. Is part of that learned behavior, or is it all innate?
the wiring, the patterns that are made. In the dish of cells, and this is why I was also extremely intrigued, it's not random. It's not like as soon as an axon reaches a dendrite, it's going to stay there and activate that cell. It seems like there's unknown things about a cell that one certain axon will either like or not. So it's not random. What you'll probably get a feeling for by the end of this talk is that it's a combination of both innate gene expression, so the right expression of growth factors and receptors, but also activity is going to sculpt these circuits. And in this sense, in this context, we're talking about visual systems, so activity being visual stimuli in the outside world actually shapes these things. Okay. So how in the world can they get this right? How can they write? How are the proper connections formed? Just as important, how are the improper, inappropriate ones not formed? Okay. These are the sorts of questions that my lab addresses. And like Paul said, it's almost impossible to address, to study this, the formation of neural circuits in a human embryo. And we carry out, our model system is a very classic and powerful model system, the Xenopus Laevis Tadpole Visual System. These are some images. I put a dime under their bowl so that you can get a sense of how big, how small these guys are. These tadpoles are approximately, I have so many things to say about them. These guys are approximately 7 days post-fertilization, which means just 5 days before this time, they were a round ball of cells. So they develop really fast, they differentiate, and not only that, they can actually by this time elicit, display visually guided behaviors. So they will avoid, for instance, moving dots that we project onto the floor of their tank. So the visual system wires itself up fast in these guys and will start to work very fast. Also, as you can see here, that for the most part, they are transparent, and their brain is situated very dorsal, so that makes it really easy for us to image and record the neurons in the visual part of the tadpole's brain. We can shine light into the eye and record the neurons in the tadpole's brain that receive input from the eye. So there's just a whole bunch of stuff that we can do it fairly easily given the $100,000 amount of equipment that it takes to build the rig to be able to do this. But it's just a great model system to study the specific time in development when the retinal ganglion cell axons are leaving the eye, traveling to the brain, and forming synaptic connections with the neurons in the brain to underlie visual behaviors, vision. Okay. And this is a zoomed in bird's eye view of a tadpole. And are you guys looking at this screen, or is it easier to look up here? All right. So you can see here that this is an overview, and the eye is here, it's slightly out of focus because the brain is here and the brain is way dorsal. So the brain is way above this eye, so I wanted to focus in on this. So here's the eye. The eye is lined with retinal ganglion cells. Those cells project their axons all the way. So these axons, it's not a relay. These axons in the eye, the cells from the eye, project all the way across to the brain, cross the brain at the midline, and synapse form connections onto the thousands and thousands of tectal neurons that are in the optic tectum. So this model has been studied for decades, like since the 1950s. So a lot's known about it. And we continue to learn things about how exactly the circuitry forms here and how that circuitry gives rise to visual behaviors. These black snowflake patterned cells are melanocytes. And they're on the surface, and what's interesting about them, as the tadpoles mature, we'll see more and more of them. They increase, and they tend to accumulate right over top of the nervous system, and it's thought that that pigment in these cells, this dark pigment, actually protects the nervous system. So it's sort of like a natural sunblock. Yeah, and so the projection, this one circuit that I'm going to talk about for the rest of my talk, is all about the retinal ganglion cells projecting to the visual part of the brain. Neuroscientists, when they're talking about a circuit like this, they give it a shorter name, and so this is referred to as the retinotectal circuit because it's the retinal ganglion cells in the eye that project to the tectal neurons in the optic part of the tadpole's brain. So I'll be focusing on this circuit for the rest of my talk. Okay. And one last plug for the tadpole. This model system also allows us to study circuit development and function across essentially all levels, meaning from the whole creature, so we can study visual guided behaviors, all the way down to whole brain, down to network, aka circuit. This is showing the retinal ganglion cell axons in red, one of them coming in and contacting one green tectal neuron. At the cell level, we can study synaptic, how strong these connections are, down to the actual number of receptors expressed. So this is your chemical transmission. So glutamate, for this circuit, glutamate is the neurotransmitter released from the retinal ganglion cell axons, and then the postsynaptic tectal neurons express AMPA and NMDA receptors, which bind glutamate.
The slide before this one, mm-hmm. Does the opposite eye go to the opposite side?
Yes, thank you. So this, the way this system is built is, so here the right, I've drawn in, these are not the actual axons, I drew those in. But this is the eye on the right projects to the optic tectum on the left and vice versa. Yeah. Okay. So like I said, this model system has been used for a long time to study the way neural circuits wire themselves up, and therefore a lot's known about it. And we know that the development of the circuit consists of three main phases, and that is the first phase is stage 42. This is only 4 days post-fertilization, so they're not displaying visually guided behaviors yet. But this is the eye, and these are two retinal ganglion cells projecting to the tectum. You can see here what I'm trying to show is that the retinal ganglion cell axons have just reached the eye and are just starting to form very immature connections onto the tectal cells here. Okay, that's 4 days post-fertilization. Then by about 5 days post-fertilization, the circuit progresses through its most dynamic phase. And this is characterized by a very high rate of synapse formation, so connections are being formed and lost at a very high rate. And this is when activity starts to play a role to sculpt the circuit to get to the next level of circuitry, which happens by day nine post-fertilization. And this is characterized You can see the difference here. This is more organized in that now any one tectal neuron is receiving fewer different inputs. But the inputs that it keeps have strengthened. And this is the definition of what off-circuit refinement. Going from a less organized condition or state like this, and then transforming, self-assembling into this. Now, I think I have one more slide to make this point. So yes, so there's not going to be a quiz, but circuit refinement is characterized by any one tectal neuron receiving fewer inputs, meaning fewer axons from the retinal ganglion cells, but those inputs that are kept get really strong. And this is not seen just in the tadpole visual system. This progression happens in any development in the development of any circuit that's been looked at. So it's a very universal style, I guess you could say, of development. And so from here to here, well, let me back up even more. So to get the retinal ganglion cell axons from the eye to the tectal neurons, remember I said it has to go all the way across the tadpole, all the way to the brain and cross over and all that, and all the way to this level here can all be and is completely explained by what we refer to as molecular cues. That's just hardwired gradients of growth factors and receptors, and I'm not going to talk much about this now. This has been worked out, and we know every molecule, essentially, that's necessary to guide these axons from the eye to the brain. What's not known so much about is how do you get from here to here? Because to get from here to here requires activity. And in this case, it's visual activity. So how does this work? So by visual activity, I really do mean things like the external environment, the visual objects, the scene, the visual scene. So for a tadpole, it might be, you know, a fish swimming by in the field of view. It could be a plant. These visual stimuli guide the refinement, allow or instruct for the refinement phase, okay? So if this fish swimming by activates the retinal ganglion cells in this eye a certain way, a patterned way, it causes them to have action potentials that course over and synapse onto tectal neurons, okay? This is what we mean by activity-dependent mechanisms. This is what we mean by activity, visually driven activity. And so if you're a cat, this could be your vision. Visual activity, so like that. All right. So, when I was a postdoc, my first postdoc at Brown, I was in Carlos Eisenman's lab, and this is when I first started studying tadpoles. And when I first started there, I raised up three of them from eggs, and until they were, it takes about actually 8 months for them to become frogs. And I raised them up and I kept them for years, and they're just amazing creatures. Then I found out, I did some research, I found out that their average lifespan is 25 years. So I'm like, oh my gosh. So, but I regress. This is not about, I'm not supposed to be talking. I'll tell you more about that over lunch. But so when I joined this lab, our question was, all right, we know refinement happens. We know it's sculpted by visual activity. But so what? What does the end result of refinement mean as far as how well the tadpole can see? So does refinement of the retinotectal circuit actually improve the tadpole's vision? The answer is probably going to be yes, because why would it bother to do that? But it had never actually been, you know, neuroscientists knew that this was true, but no one had ever been able to demonstrate how a refined circuit is different functionally than an unrefined one. So this is the project that I worked on while a postdoc in this lab, and we, while there, we developed what's called very high tech, the moving dot test. And what we do is, because we needed a way to test tadpole vision, and so that we can link up, we can do experiments to link up circuit refinement and vision, visual function. So the moving dot test involves putting the tadpoles in a clear bowl and setting that bowl on a computer screen that we programmed moving dots. So this was not as easy as I make it sound. It took a long time to find just the right size of the dot that gives the best result. But so if we found that if we expose the tadpoles to moving dots projected onto the floor of their tank, they, a lot of the times, they will dodge them. So I'm going to give you an example. Now, so keep in mind as you're watching this, this is an eight days post-fertilization, meaning, again, just 5 days ago, he was a round ball of cells. So, and I'm going to play this several times, so you can keep your eye on one. There's four tadpoles in that bowl, and you can sort of see them dodge. If you look at any one, follow the trajectory, the path of any one, you might see him dodge a dot. This is not an optical illusion. All right, do you guys see it? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so my students love, so I have two graduate students and I have two very talented undergrads. And they love coming in and scoring these guys. There's just something very peaceful and relaxing about watching these. So I'll come in and they'll just be at the computer scoring them. Like, did he? So what we do is we score each tadpole. We watch five interactions. Do they dodge the dot or not? And I'm probably giving away the really interesting result here, but the bottom line is these are stage 48, 49. So these ones, their circuit has refined, and they dodge about 70% of the time on a good day. Sometimes it's 60, but 60 to 70% of the time when they encounter a dot, they will dodge it. All right. The interesting thing is, if you test them before the circuit has refined, when they're still in that unrefined dynamic stage, they're really bad at this test. So they're about 30%, 20 to 30%. All right. So that led us, and I'm going to now get into probably the most difficult part of my talk, but I think it's, I just want to give you guys something to think about that maybe you don't normally think about. So I'm going to walk you through an experiment of how we quantify or measure refinement, because it is not an easy thing. Although the schematic looks nice and neat, you can see the axons becoming more focused in space, and any one tectal neuron receiving stronger input but fewer different ones. But actually, it's really hard. It's a very sophisticated way, an experiment to actually measure this. And so I'm going to walk you through. This is the toughest part of my entire talk. So to start out with, and the reason we wanted to do this, because we really wanted to link the ability of the tadpoles to avoid the moving dots with refinement. So that's why we had to come up with a way to measure this. So we have a tadpole on our electrophysiology rig, and we, first of all, we can access the tectal neurons It would be, if we're activating this eye, we would be recording from neurons on the opposite side, right? So we're, and this is what the neurons look like. You can just see their somas, their cell bodies. This is at 60x, very high magnification. This cell right here, the diameter of the cell is probably no more than 10 microns. So they're really, really small cells. And we have customized pipettes that we can go in and form a seal onto the cell, break the membrane underneath that pipette, and that gives us access so we can listen in on the activity. We can record the activity from individual neurons in this living in vivo. All right, so these are the tectal neurons. These are the ones that are receiving the direct input from the retinal, from the eye. Okay, so we do that. We're on one cell. Now I'm going to walk you through the experiment. We're recording from one cell. We have this optic fiber that we place up against the tadpole's eye. This optic fiber, and this diagram does not show it very clearly, so I'm just going to explain it. Inside the optic fiber is a grid, a 4x3 grid, projected onto the tadpole's eye, which lets us light up different regions of the eye, one at a time. All right. So, for instance, maybe the first light just activates this region, and then the next light we move it, we turn it on, and it activates this region. And so we have a grid of four different lights this way, and three different down this way. So, as we're recording from our one cell, we just start. We activate first. Grid block number one, and on this part of the eye, and that's going to evoke, that's going to activate, so light's going to come through, activate just the retinal ganglion cells in that one part of the eye. Those retinal ganglion cells, their axons are going to go down, and if our cell that we're recording is receiving synaptic input from those exact retinal cells, then you will see a response that looks something like this. So this is in voltage clamp, and the downward inflections are depolarizations, which is activity. So we go through this whole, every part of the eye we light up one at a time as we record the response. And then we can combine all of those responses into this very nice, neat image plot. All right? So this is the code for this. The darkest means lowest activity, and red means intermediate amounts of activity, and yellow means very high, like a very strong response. All right. So for this, what I'm showing you here, no matter where we activated the eye, this one neuron gave pretty good responses all across. Of course, its highest, its strongest response came when the light was on this part of the eye, right? But for the most part, there's no dark. Everything's light. This is characteristic of an unrefined circuit. So the axons, the retinal ganglion cell axons, are still covering a large area. They haven't refined yet. And so this is what an unrefined image plot looks like. This is great because this gave us a way to measure refinement, right? So we did this experiment. First, we wanted to confirm that yes, indeed, over development, it starts out overlapping and coarse, and refinement takes place, and you end up with any one cell that you record from is going to be receiving it's going to be receiving input from just a specific area of the eye instead of a very broad area, right? And that's exactly what we see. So stage 44 to 46, this is the unrefined stage, very broad. You see activity across almost every area of the eye that we activate. We see activity. It's strongest right here, but overall there's no dark. This is another example. So tadpole 1 and tadpole 2. And then here we're seeing that a very different pattern. And this is refinement. This is because refinement has taken place. Now we see that there's areas that we activate in the eye that almost no response at all. And so this is because now the circuit is more refined and the neurons, the tectal neurons, are receiving fewer different inputs. All right? So this is great. This gave us a way. This makes sense. Somebody else, we were not the ones who discovered this, but now we have a way to measure this. So, a lot of,
Does that mean the visual acuity has enhanced as it matures?
Yes. So what I haven't said, and what maybe I would have said, I'm not sure, but the refinement is, in this case, the refinement of the circuit is equivalent to acuity. Yes. All right. So now, typically what you do in research, when you discover something like this and you want to know, let's just say we hypothesize that activity, visual stimuli, visual scenes are required to go from this to this. Right? So how do we test that? Well, typically if you want to test the function of something, the role that something plays, you take it away. That's the experiment. You take it away and see what happens. So we take away visually driven activity by blocking the receptors between the retinal ganglion cells and the tectal neurons. We block those receptors chronically, meaning for many, many days, while the circuit is in this phase. We keep them blocked. We let the tadpoles develop to this stage, stage 48, 49, and then we do the same experiment, test their receptive fields, and test them on the moving dot test. So, what we found when we did this, so now nothing's changed except now we're blocking visually driven activity. And we're letting the tadpoles grow up to stage 48, 49, which should be their refined stage. And we see that the circuit did not refine. It's not quite as immature as the other ones, but it is not as refined. This pattern does not match the normally refined pattern. Well, I knew someone was going to ask that. I wish it was that simple, but it's really, as it turns out, to block activity for several days, keep in complete darkness is really hard. And inadvertently, a student will come in to feed the tadpoles and pull the drawer out, and I'm like, no. But not just that, but very, very, the lowest levels of activity is enough to get refinement. And that's a really good point. So yeah, you need extreme differences in visual scenes to disrupt the normal circuit. It's not just like if you were a kid and you only saw black and white TV that your vision is not going to be as good. You know, you have to really be extreme with it. A lot, and we're not the only lab who does this. A more direct, complete way to really block those receptors, the block visually driven activity, is just to simply pharmacologically block the receptors. Yeah.
Did you have when you cut between the eyes and the brain? Did you cut that circuit?
If you cut that circuit, the tadpoles are completely blind. Yeah.
How'd they know it broke?
It's really well known the transmitter that's released from the eye, the retinal ganglion cells, that is glutamate, and it's well known that the tectal neurons express AMPA receptors, and so that's what we do. We block AMPA, the glutamate receptors. Yeah. It would be nice if I could just say, oh, just raise them in the dark and then you see this, but no one's been able to see a real shift in refinement, a real disruption of refinement by just raising in the dark. And we're not really sure why.
So that is. Did they catch up to their...
No.
What is the chemical you use to block?
We use to block NMDA receptors, we use AP5, and to block the AMPA receptors, we use DNQX or CNQX. We didn't have to optimize any of this. This is very well known drugs that a lot of neuroscientists use just for experiments such as this. What's the role of AMPA receptors in synaptic transmission? Block them and see what happens to synaptic transmission. These experiments have been done for decades, so which is nice because we don't have to work that out. All right, so I don't have a slide for this, but the bottom line is when you disrupt, when you block visually driven activity like this, you prevent the refinement. Also, and this was the big deal, the tadpoles no longer avoid the moving dots as well. So it's really stalling the system and the output, resulting visual behavior, it's really being stalled at this more immature stage. Okay? So that was a nice display of how activity-dependent refinement allows for or underlies visual acuity. Okay. And so the conclusions for this experiment. The retinotectal circuit refinement is an activity-driven process. It requires visually driven activity, and it gives rise to improved performance on the moving dot test. Okay. So when I started my lab here in 2011, we were still interested in, sort of continued this. What else might activity, visually driven activity, do to organize this circuitry? And this is my favorite part of the talk. So we discovered, my little lab discovered, that visually driven activity also guides the retinal ganglion cell axons to specific regions of the dendrite. Okay, so I'm showing here, this is on our rig, these are the neurons, the cell bodies here, and I have this image is positioned such that the somas are here, the cell bodies are here, and they project their dendrites out into what's referred to as the neuropil. Maybe you can see that here we have all these cell bodies, it's sort of cobblestone look, but out here it's smoother. That's because all of these cells here are projecting their dendrites up into this neuropil, and they contact, and then the retinal ganglion cell axons come down and contact here. But they contact only in a very specific region of this dendrite, and they contact way out here, far away from the soma. So why is that? How does that work? Well, what we helped describe or discover is that, oh well, we didn't discover this, but amphibians and fish have what are known, what are called lateral lines. And it's so here's a very healthy looking Xenopus frog. Yes, he has eyes and he uses his eyes to capture prey. He will eat whatever he can fit into his mouth. They don't have teeth or tongues, they just push the food in and they just swallow it. But he's using his eyes to capture prey, but also you see these like thread-like structures like a baseball. So that's his lateral line, and it's a mechanosensory neural system, sensory system, such that if a fish were to swim by or something were to create a current, and the frog could feel that via these sensory systems here. So the lateral line neurons, those axons feed up through the brainstem and synapse form connections onto the tactile neurons. So now we can add to our circuit diagram like this. So here the retinal ganglion cell axons always come in and contact out here. The lateral line axons always contact down lower, so closer to the soma. And this was striking us, like, how does it get that right? How can you, this is what we refer to as subcellular segregation. It's very fancy. All that means is these retinal ganglion cell axons are being targeted to the more distal part of this dendrite, and these guys, the lateral line ones, are being targeted closer in. So we found, so to test something, what do? We block activity. We want to see, is activity dependent to get this level of organization? So we blocked activity. We block visually driven activity the same way we did with the moving dot test. And this is normal. This is a schematic showing the normal situation. We have the retinal ganglion cells coming in up top, and I call them HB because they're coming up through the hind brain. These are a lateral line coming in closer. If you just add that same drug to block the receptors that are involved in visual and also lateral line synaptic transmission, you totally disrupt the segregation, and now they overlap. Okay? This suggested to us, and we're coming down the home stretch, this suggested to us a competition-based. So not only is visually driven activity required, this may be they're competing and keeping staying away from each other through some sort of competition mechanism. Well, how can we test that? We tested it by taking one of the inputs away. So at very early larval stage, embryonic stage 32, this is before the axons have even left the eye, we took one eye away. We dissected the eye out. And then we let the tadpoles survive. They're fine. We let them grow up to this stage where this should be, this pattern has formed. And so this, we take one eye out. And the non-visual lateral line inputs move into the territory that's usually reserved for the, are occupied by the visual inputs. Okay.
Did you reverse it where you could take it out of the lateral line so you could see which came first?
We talked about that. We couldn't figure out a way to do it. But that would be really good. One thing that suggests that it might still work the same way is both of these inputs arrive at the tectum at the same time. We didn't discover that, somebody else discovered that. But, and that also led us to hypothesize that this truly could be guided by competition between the two. Because it's not like one showing up first, who knows what would happen. I would expect something like this. But they arrive at the tectum at the same time. Very good.
Did you want to say that if you interrupt that, it never is able to catch up? In other words, once you provide the stimuli,
bring it back.
That it will reorganize or not.
Excellent. So this also implies you're getting at developmental plasticity versus, does that plasticity, is it maintained? And the answer is, it is not, it seems to be a purely developmental plasticity, because when we block those receptors after the circuit has formed, if we wait till stage 48, when we have refinement and everything's pretty mature, they don't move. They don't overlap. So you can only make them overlap and lose their patterning if you block the receptors while the circuit is forming, in the midst of forming. It doesn't move, it doesn't have that plasticity after the circuit has formed. Yeah. So my conclusions, neurons have the amazing ability to self-assemble into circuits. It's a combination of activity-independent molecular cues and then followed by this very interesting activity-dependent mechanisms. I want to say something that Richard Feynman said in some of his physics talks, that it's not that we figured this out, it's that this is what the neurons are doing. Circuit development involves both activity-independent guidance supplied by molecular cues, followed by activity-dependent refinement. The refined tadpole visual system allows them to be good at avoiding scary moving dots, meaning that probably the refinement in real life, in natural life, the refinement allows them to, at a very early stage, be able to avoid possible predators.
We do have some time for questions, so if you'd like to point some towards Tara.
If you add a neurotoxin like mercury to the water, will the possibly the moving dot test change?
If we add what?
A neurotoxin like mercury. In other words, could the moving dot test be used as a way to determine mercury levels or the effect of that?
We are doing the exact thing. So this moving dot test, even though it's simple, it's because it's simple and very inexpensive, we are using it as a screen to characterize the effects of all the neuroactive agents that are coming out of the Laramie River wastewater treatment plant. There's about 60 or 80 different things, and about half of those things are neuroactive. There's Prozac, cocaine, caffeine, anti-migraine medications, very low levels. And we did receive a little bit of EPSCoR funding to do just what you're sort of, what you've implied. So it's a really nice, and my students can do this. Students, they, like I said, they love doing the moving dot test. They will sit and watch and score them and make their own graphs. And then if they fail their moving dot test, then we take them to the EPHYS rig and we record. Is the reason they're not avoiding the dots truly because their visual system has been compromised? We can test that directly by shining a light in their eye and recording from the tactile neurons. But yeah, it's good. Is there any more questions? Yes.
I just wonder, are there other ways in which what you have learned you are applying to problems in the world or to the human eye, et cetera?
Well, not directly, I must admit, but we feel that what I tell my students is to fix something, if you ever want to fix something, it's way easier if you know how it's built. And so, you know, I had this really beat up old Pinto when I was a kid, a Ford Pinto, and it broke down a lot. My father, we'd take it to get it fixed, and the mechanic would say, crank it up. So I'd turn the car on, and he'd know what's wrong. I'm like, how do you know what's wrong? He goes, because I build these things. So we sort of work off the premise that it's much easier to know how to fix something if you know how it's built. And I think Paul alluded to this, the tadpole visual system, especially the retinotectal, is the receptors and the growth factors and the neurotransmitters are very similar to those in mammals, including humans. There's very, very subtle differences. So, It's interesting. I had slide. I don't know what happened to my slides, but let's just say the visual system is slightly askew. Let's say your right and left eye, the maps, the circuitry formed back in your visual cortex is slightly misaligned. Well, what does that lead to? That's a condition called strabismus. And as it turns out, if your circuitry is not aligned in the right and left eye, you no longer have three-dimensional perception. Everything's 2D. As it turns out, many famous painters, artists, have this condition. Picasso, Rembrandt, Marc Chagall, Ed Hopper. They had strabismus. And the idea is that maybe, since they only see in two dimensions, for them to convey what they're seeing on the canvas is very straightforward. They don't have to collapse three dimensions into two. All right. And I told my student this. He goes, but their paintings look three-dimensional. I'm like, that's because you can see it. Yes.
Is it possible that when the input from the retina comes in and the other one H-something?
Yeah, the lateral.
They always go to the same spot?
Mm-hmm.
Does the one from the retina speak to the one that's lower and closer to the someone?
We don't think about speaking to it, but I will say we are studying now the synergistic effect of having both of those inputs onto the same tectal neuron. So all those tectal neurons receive input from both inputs, the visual and non-visual. So it's not, we don't have evidence that they actually speak to one another, but they definitely contribute as a team to driving that cell and making it fire an action potential. And that study is all about sensory integration, and that's a huge field. But
when you're projecting the light into the eyes and doing the grid,
mm-hmm.
is it the same color light, or do you do different spectrums of the?
Very good, yeah. So we don't study all the different, the responses to different colors. Interestingly, this always cracks me up. So the tectal cells respond best to green light, because frogs are green. I don't know. So they respond best to the wavelength 560, 570 nanometers. That's green. That looks green to at least us. I don't know what it looks like through a frog's eyes. But we haven't studied the effects of different colors. Yes?
Since this relates to mammals, would you say keep the mobile active above the crib?
Yes, I'm sure that wouldn't hurt, but like I also said, it takes a really extreme visual, long-term visual deprivation. So they did this study back in the 60s, they did these awful cat experiments where they would raise kittens in nothing but diagonal lights, diagonal moving bars of light. For a long, that's all they ever saw, and then they were blind to vertical moving bars of light. So for sure, visual stimuli instructs the way the visual circuits working. It's interesting to me because visual stimuli is instructing the circuit to see that visual stimuli best. So it's kind of a circular thing. One more thing, I think we can talk more about this at lunch, but one more thing before I go, I just want to say most of the work was done by my PhD student, Ali Hamodi, who just defended his thesis, his PhD, last summer, and he's now postdocing at Michael Crayer's lab at Yale. We're very proud of him for that. And so thank you all for coming.